Welcome to HCS Talks. I'm your host, Superintendent of Hampton City Schools, Raymond Haynes. Welcome to the second season of HCS Talks, the Hampton City Schools podcast. Our goal is to educate, inform, and entertain not just our local community, but also listeners far and wide. In each episode, we dive into a variety of topics, from education and student success to the hard work of our teachers, support staff, parents, and community partners. We will also shine a spotlight on different programs, initiatives, and more, offering valuable insights for everyone. To our loyal listeners, thank you for your continued support. And if this is your first time tuning in, welcome. We hope you will stick around and keep listening to HCS Talks. Today, I have the opportunity to sit down with Ms. Kimberly Judge, our Director of Special Education, and discuss not just the special education process, but also how the division is committed to providing specially designed instruction via high-leverage practices for all students with disabilities. Welcome, Ms. Judge. Thank you for joining us today on HCS Talks. Before we dive into our discussion, please introduce yourself to the listening audience.
Yes, thank you so much, Dr. Haynes. I am Kimberly Judge, Director of Special Education here in Hampton City Schools, with over 31 years of education of students with disabilities and also serving as a building level principal previously. I bring to Hampton City School and collaborate with Hampton City School to ensure that we are educating every child every day, whatever it takes.
And you do a phenomenal job at that as well. One of the benefits of having you serve in this capacity, Ms. Judge, is that, and you mentioned it, you actually served as a building principal as well. So talk a little bit about your experiences prior to becoming a director of special education.
Yes. So I started this career as actually an instructional assistant back in the 90s in Texas. And after that time, I was able to transition into a teaching position, working with students with multiple disabilities, both verbal and nonverbal students in another state. Since that time, I've had the opportunity to be afforded opportunities to teach as well as serve as a curriculum specialist for students with autism, later becoming an autism specialist, then an instructional supervisor for students with disabilities. And after that time, I transitioned into elementary school principal. And now I've been serving in the capacity of director of special education.
So you said elementary principal. Were you an assistant principal too?
No, sir, I was not.
So folks saw that skill set in you and just automatically catapulted you to the principalship. Was it elementary, middle, or high?
It was elementary.
How long did you do that?
I served in that capacity for 4 years.
4 years. And you said Texas. Are you from Texas?
I am. I'm originally from Houston, Texas.
And what brought you here to the great city of Hampton or this great state of Virginia?
My husband was actually a naval officer, and so we were stationed here years ago, and we've had opportunities to go on different tours, but actually found our home here in Virginia and came back to this area.
Nice. We're glad you chose Virginia and Hampton City Schools as well. Do you have children?
I do. I have three wonderful children. I have a 32-year-old mechanical engineer. I have a 25-year-old special education. It's kind of in the same vein, but she is a school psychologist in Fairfax County. And then I also have an 18-year-old son who is a freshman in college.
Freshman in college. All right. What is he studying? Has he declared a major yet?
He has. He's going to do school psychology, but possibly clinical psychology. And he's actually at Virginia Military Institute as a baseball player.
Wow. I forgot he is an athlete as well. He did exceptionally well in baseball, didn't he?
He has. He has. Yes. He is a student athlete, though. We put people first. So
focus
he's a
on student.
Absolutely.
So, did he get a scholarship, I'm sure, academic and athletically?
Yes, sir, he has.
Full ride?
Not a full ride, but just about.
And he is playing baseball?
And he is playing baseball.
Have they started season yet?
Yes, so they do fall ball, so they've done inner squad and some scrimmages.
Okay, so you've been to some?
I've been to everyone.
All right, so talk a little bit about how Hampton City Schools approaches the development and implementation of special education programs.
Okay. So here in Hampton City Schools, we provide a spectrum or an array or continuum of services for students with disabilities. So we plan and we program for each individual student at the school level as well as at the division level. We provide services anywhere from just supplemental aids and supports in classrooms all the way to more restrictive and more intensive needs and supports based on the student's individualized and unique needs.
So, and this is a question I often get when I'm speaking to a bunch of internal and external stakeholders, particularly external stakeholders. What kinds of support and resources are available? What kinds of support and resources are available to ensure that students with disabilities receive a quality education?
That's a great question. So we partner with all of our stakeholders to include our families, our students, our staff, as well as community partnerships. And so in that, we make sure that any individualized needs as outlined on a student's individualized education plan, their IEP, is implemented and implemented with fidelity. We have human resources that we use as a level of support, as well as other resources to include our viable curriculum. We work collaboratively with our curriculum leads as well as teachers. We also make sure that we provide service professional development opportunities for all individuals that work with students with disabilities to ensure that they are able to provide that specially designed instruction as outlined on a student's IEP.
So to piggyback on something you just mentioned, the guaranteed and viable curriculum, we make certain that students with disabilities are receiving that quality tier one instruction, correct?
Absolutely.
They are all owe that right to receive quality tier one instruction. So what types of supports do we put in place to ensure that a young person with a disability is able to perform at his or her highest level?
It's a great question. So our guaranteed and viable curriculum has differentiated instruction in it that helps to support that specially designed instruction. Additionally, my department collaborates with CIA, so our curriculum instruction and assessment teams, to ensure that we provide inclusive and collaborative professional development. So that happens at minimal, at least four times a year, but we start with pre-service and ensure that not just teachers that are providing that frontline tier one instruction, but also building administrators have an understanding for the unique, diverse needs of students with disabilities, and if not individually, how to relate and connect with them and provide that service. They have resources, so we have coordinators, we have specialists, and other individuals that work collaboratively to ensure that the specially designed instruction is implemented with fidelity.
Outstanding. I know that you, in your role, you're also instrumental in doing instructional walks along with our directors and chiefs of schools to look at that instruction to determine if there are specific needs or things that need to be adjusted in the instruction to meet the needs of students with disabilities as well. So talk a little bit about that process.
Yes. So we do go on collaborative walks, not only with curriculum leaders and directors of elementary and secondary leadership, but we also go on collaborative walks with the building administrators to help them understand what specially designed instruction should look like, sound like, and feel like in the inclusion classes as well in our classes that are programs. We pride ourselves here in Hampton City Schools on understanding that special education is a service. It's not a place. And so just as you mentioned earlier, we ensure that it's people first language, so students with a disability, so they're a student first, just as all other non-developed, non-disabled peers, and then they receive something in addition to, so whatever is outlined on their individualized education plan, that's in addition to, and so we help and go out and collaborate and do the instructional walks with all of the other leads so they see what those environments look like for our students with disabilities.
So I love that. Special education is a service and not a place. So recognizing when a young person is found eligible to receive special education services, it is just that, and not a place. So we recognize a young person being in a classroom, he or she is receiving that quality tier one instruction, and the service that comes with it ensures that a young person is setting themselves up for success as well.
Absolutely.
And we make the necessary adjustments as needed, correct?
Yes. IEPs are always working documents.
Yes, ma'am. So what kind of training and ongoing support does the school division provide for special education teachers and support staff?
So in addition to our collaborative learning teams, which every school has, and they have those meetings on a weekly basis, so we call those CLTs. In addition to that, my team of coordinators and also specialists provide ongoing job embedded training. So that can look anywhere from coaching, so going into the classroom to help with class setting up the classroom, so classroom configuration. They also help with behavioral concerns and needs, as well as that guaranteed and viable curriculum. So how do we implement that curriculum? How do we differentiate the curriculum to ensure that it is specially designed? And then how do we take data on those IEP goals that we're affording and teaching our young scholars on each day? And then not just take that data, but how do we let that data inform the work that our teachers need to know and be able to do in order to ensure that we're educating our students?
Another excellent point. So it's not just a set criteria for professional development, looking at that data and being intentional in terms of what types of professional development needs to be in place to ensure our young people continue to perform and our staff continues to perform at the highest level as well.
Yes.
All right. How do you work with general education teachers to ensure they feel equipped to support students with special needs? And you spoke a little bit about that earlier, but if there's some things you want to elaborate on, that would be great.
Yes, I will highlight in particular our work with our ELA team as well as our math department. So with ELA, our literacy team, we have a collaboration with them where we go out and we train schools. So school-based teams on our new Virginia Literacy Act and the implementation of our revised curriculum based on that Literacy Act. So there are collaborative teams that have provided that training. Additionally, we provided job-embedded training during pre-service. So for our special education teachers and our general education teacher teams, so that would be our inclusion teacher teams, they received job-embedded professional development prior to students returning on what that curriculum looks like and then how we need to differentiate the curriculum. We've also made some modifications and adaptations to that curriculum to ensure that we are addressing every learner's needs.
Nice. Nicely stated. What are some of the processes in place to identify and evaluate students who may need special education services?
Thank you for asking that question, because we have a legal obligation and a responsibility to the child find process. So we are required by law to identify students and then take them through the eligibility process if we or their parents suspect that they may be an individual with a disability.
So talk about the child find. You mentioned the child find process. What is that?
The child find process is actually when a student may be identified, so a parent sees or understands or feels like there is something going on different with their child in their development. From birth to age 21, and we start at age 2, we go through a child find screening process, and we have a team of individuals to include school psychologists, social workers, and some of our trained early childhood special education teachers and also coordinators that sit on a team. They do a screening, they do a parent interview, and just talk about the development of that child and how that child is presenting as an individual, and then identify if there are possibly some needs for early intervening services. We do work collaboratively with our EI, so our early intervening committee of individuals here in Hampton City, which is why we are One Community, One Transformation. So we work collaboratively with them. And if they are providing early intervening services and they also may see that something is different, then they make a referral to the school division. And it is our obligation to follow through with that referral to see if there is a need for some additional evaluations, and then to go through that process to see if the child is eligible or just needs some additional time to grow and develop.
So a parent can make a referral if he or she suspects, or if they suspect they have some issues in regards to learning or processing. Who else can make a referral?
Anyone can make a referral. So a doctor can make a referral. Teachers can make referrals. Parents can make referrals. The early intervening individuals that are working with them. A daycare can say something to their parent if they suspect that there is something going on. Sometimes and many times it's just a need for opportunity. Right. But there are unique and individual circumstances where young scholars do present with some additional needs and need that specially designed instruction.
So they go through the child find process, and you mentioned the folks who are on that committee. So what happens after that? Are there assessments, or you determine what type of assessments need to be done, or what does that look like?
If they're little people, then that would be mostly a screening. So there are screenings and then parent interviews just to see how the child is growing and developing, and then there are screenings that are done. So there may be observations of a student in natural play environments to see how that child is functioning. If they're school-age individuals, then that takes a little bit of a different turn, and we do actually go into formalized protocol where we look at some evaluations, and those are done by school psychologists, and then also social culturals, which are done by the social workers, just to get background knowledge about family history and things of that nature, so that school-based teams can make informed decisions and based on the student's needs. And so then there's also, if they're school age, they also look into the child's educational background as well as their social emotional development, and they combine all of those things together so that we have a holistic picture of the student.
Okay. And then they come to what is called the eligibility process or eligibility meeting. Is
yes,
it still called
sir.
That?
It is. Okay, Dr. Haynes. Then they come to the eligibility process, and it is a multiple tiered process. So they have to be identified as a student in one of the 14 disability categories that we acknowledge here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. And in addition to that, there has to be an adverse educational impact on the student. And in addition to that, there must be some type of specially designed instruction that can be put in place to address those adverse educational impacts.
So, sounds like the essential questions would be, does the student or young person have a disability? And the second part of that is, does that disability adversely impact his or her educational performance? So those two things have to be yes, right?
Yes.
And then that is what determines whether or not a young person is eligible to receive special education services.
Not just those two things. So yes, those two things, absolutely. But also there has to be some form of specially designed instruction that can be put in place to address that student's needs so that we can basically level the playing field.
Wow. Wow. So that's good for the audience, the listening audience, to understand all of that, because it's not just as simple as you think a person has, your child has a disability. Okay. But if he or she is performing at, you know, high levels or performing successfully in class, then that doesn't necessarily mean it's adversely impacting his or her educational performance, correct?
That's correct.
All right. So how do you ensure that students' individualized education programs, or IEPs, or 504 plans are tailored to their specific needs?
So we train on that first and foremost, because it is important for the I and the individualized to really be impactful, because that's the only way that we can make sure that we're providing students with with education in their least restrictive environment, and we're not denying them their free appropriate education. So to ensure that, we make sure that we train teachers and also those general educators that are developing and implementing those individualized education plans, so they understand that if it is for Kimberly Judge, it truly has to be for Kimberly Judge. So if I have a working memory deficit and they're working on me going into an algebra class that has multi-step equations, they have to help me figure out how to address my working memory deficit so that I can solve more than one step. And so sometimes, and I use this as an example a lot, students that have working memory deficits may sometimes present as being defiant, because a teacher will say, okay, Kim, go in, put your books down, get your Chromebook out, open up to the Google Classroom, and let's get started. Well, that's about two or three different steps that they've addressed or asked me to do. And I come in and I get my Chromebook, but I don't go to Google Classroom and open it up. And so then they look at me as being a defiant kid or non-compliant kid, right, when I really just only heard that one step. And so they need to break it down for me. I may need it written out, or I may need some other type of intervention put in place so that I can go ahead and do the things that I have to get done.
So there is no cookie cutter approach to young people in the IEPs or 504s, and it really is individualized to meet the needs of that young person. And like you said earlier, it's not just a document you put in place and say it's done. It's a working document. If you see some adjustments or things that need to be amended, then you go back. Correct?
Yes,
What does that process look like?
So at any given time, a parent and or a student and or an educator can say, we need to come back and review this IEP. So at least annually, IEPs have to be reviewed and revised, so rewritten based on current data. But parents and or educators can at any time request that the IEP team come back and reconvene and have do it, what's called an addendum meeting. Mm-hmm. So review the data and make some adjustments, or if parents come with some additional information that they want the IEP team to consider, they can request that opportunity as well.
So how does, or what's the difference between an IEP and a 504? How do they differ? And what steps are involved in a 504 versus an IEP?
So the biggest difference with an IEP and a 504 plan is that an IEP is a legally binding document that's governed by a law. So we have a law in place, that federal law, that governs the education of students with disabilities. A 504 plan could be something that's temporary, or it could be something that spans for a child's more longer than the child, longer than there is a need. So a 504 plan could be something for medical limitations, but it just protects students from not being discriminated on based on whatever their disability is, and then provides them accommodations, whereas an IEP provides services, supports, and accommodations.
Okay. Can a individual have an IEP and a 504?
Yes and no. So yes, they can legally have an IEP and a 504 plan. Good practice is if there is a need for the IEP, then things that the accommodations that would have been afforded to a student with the 504 plan can be transferred over into the IEP, so that we're noting and dating data and progress or lack thereof on one document.
So would this be a good example? I'm just trying to help the listening audience. Young person breaks their leg, and they need some accommodations throughout that time until they have healed. Would a 504 need to be put in place for a situation like that?
Or if they have some additional accommodations that are needed, there are standard things that schools put in place, because, of course, we care about all of our kids.
Right.
So we want to ensure their safety. So if there are standard things that schools can put in place, that doesn't necessarily warrant the need for a 504 plan. But if additional accommodations are needed to be put in place to ensure that the child has access to their education, then absolutely, that's a great example. So thank you for that.
Yes, ma'am. So what steps do our schools take to involve parents and families in the creation and implementation of the IEPs?
Well, parents are a very viable part of that IEP team, because it's their child. And so we definitely want to make sure that we're collaborative in bringing them to the table and having informed dialogue with them about the education of their children. And we want to hear from them, not just the students' goals, but what are their goals and aspirations for their children. So they play a vital role in being a part of that educational plan for their students. So we make every effort and every attempt to ensure that we have open lines of communication, and that we have teachers that are reaching out to parents early on to welcome them and to introduce themselves to them, talk to them about the process, because it can be a very laborious process. So we just want to make sure.
It can be
a little bit intimidating. So we don't want to come to the table with jargon. We want to come to the table with the students as our target, and that's our focus. And we want to make sure that we're ensuring that our students are receiving their appropriate education in light of their unique circumstances.
So what is your approach to inclusive education, and how do our schools and staff promote inclusive practices for students with disabilities?
Well, you know, I'm a big cheerleader for equitable access for all students. And so here in Hampton, we do a phenomenal job with ensuring that our students have opportunities to their education and the same education as their non-disabled peers. So, and I'll use the swim program as an example. I know that when we initially started that second grade swimming program, I was brought to the table because they wanted to ensure that we were providing access to all students. And so we were very innovative in our approach and our collaborative efforts in working with our stakeholders and our all of the individuals involved to ensure that not just transportation was afforded to kids, but if we had kids that have sensory needs, we addressed those. And we had individuals who were trained to work with students that may present differently to ensure that our students with disabilities had the same access to their education as every other student. And so I think that that's a prime example of who we are here in Hampton City Schools and how we work to be truly inclusive.
The audience can't see this, but Ms. Judge's eyes light up when she talks about making certain we have equitable access for all young people, because that is what she is all about. So how do you address equity in special education, ensuring all students have access to the support they need, regardless of their background?
Communication and education are critical. So people don't know what they don't know until they know it. And so that's why I try to stay out in front of individuals and educate them on what has to be happening for our students with disabilities. So I thank our division leadership team for affording me opportunities to not just have time to talk with their building administrators, but to also go on those instructional walks and to help to educate them on the education of students for students with disabilities, because it really makes a difference. And when building principals see what the great things that are going on in all of the classes, whether it's an inclusion classroom or a program classroom where students have some more intense support, then it just is enlightening because they see that all kids truly can learn. Yes, we learn at different rates, but we all can learn.
Yes, ma'am. So how do you collaborate with community organizations and agencies to support students and families outside of school?
A lot of collaboration in the world of special education. So just last week, I was at Department of Human Services because I meet with them monthly. I sit on the CPMT, and if I should probably shouldn't have said the acronym because I can't remember. It's Community Partners Management Team, and it includes stakeholders throughout the city of Hampton to include those individuals with court services, social services, and the likes, because we talk about wraparound support. So right. We're very intentional. Yeah, just like we are here in education, we're very intentional about wraparound supports and services and the collaborative partnership with all of our stakeholders across the city to ensure that we're talking about our young scholars on a more holistic base. So not just what they're doing in the school, but how are we supporting them outside of the school so that we can ensure that everything is aligned and we're maximizing opportunities for students in a very intentional way.
Nice. So I understand we also have things in place like SEAC, the Special Education Advisory Council. Talk a little bit about that and what it entails.
Yes, thank you for that, because we're actually doing another membership drive. We actually had Tuesday transition meetings. So we have transition fairs and meetings with parents. And so we had an opportunity to talk to a number of parents. We had a chairperson and a vice chair that were appointed the latter part of this past school year. That chairperson has relocated outside of the state. And so we're revamping our membership drive and we're looking to have our first meeting in January. So look for that information to come out on HCS Talks, is it? Yes, HCS Talks, and then also look in your child's schools to get a form that will be shared with you so that you can come out and be a part of our Special Education Advisory Committee. That is a time when parents get to come together and further educate themselves about educational services for students with disabilities. They also get to network with other parents that may have students with disabilities here in Hampton City Schools. And then at the end of the school year, we do a big SEAC and Special Education Department Resource Fair, and that's typically in early May. So look for that to come out as well, where we have all of our vendors from across Hampton City that come out and talk about the services that they provide to parents and students of individuals with disabilities.
Great way to engage internal and external stakeholders and solicit feedback and continuing to support our mantra of one community, one transformation. So, and I'm sure that we'll have opportunities to get them on HCS Talks as well as HCS Connects and further inform the community about all the resources and services we have here in Hampton City Schools.
Yes.
So, Ms. Judge, last question. Can you share a success story or memorable experience that highlights the impact of special education?
So, you always, everyone, we talk about beginning with the end in mind.
Yes.
So if I say let's begin with the end in mind, we always want to make sure that our students leave us college, career, and life ready.
Yes.
And I can just proudly say that Hampton City Schools has 100% graduation rate, which is the biggest success story that we have. So we get our kids, we provide those early intervening services that we talk about, and we make sure that we see them through. And when we say see them through post-secondary outcomes, we do follow our students once they graduate to ensure that they are still having access to those opportunities and experiences that they were afforded when they were here in Hampton City Schools.
Wow. So 100% of our students with disabilities have graduated on time, and you all further track what they're doing post-high school to
yes.
determine if there are additional supports, I guess, that are needed for them.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Actually, I was talking to a community partner the other day And he was talking about he just opened a ice cream parlor, and he has quite a few students that are gainfully employed there through Hampton City Schools. And I was telling him about a few of our young scholars, and he said, well, I need more. And I was like, we're going to send them your way. So we have a phenomenal transition specialist and also a great team of high school individuals who work to ensure that they're tracking those students. And we don't just do it just because, or we don't just say that we're doing it. We're required by state. Every school division is required by state to track students. But for us, it's very rewarding that we get to hear about the great post-secondary outcomes that our young scholars are being able to be afforded.
Now, I know I said that was the last question. That is a good note to end on, but it triggered a thought for me. Do we have a relationship, a partnership with Centera where we're doing some things as well, working with our students with disabilities?
We absolutely do. We are a part of what is called Project Search. Mm-hmm. It is a national transition service where we afford students the opportunity to go to Centera, and they partner with individuals in varying departments. They have what's called a skills worker that works with them to train them on how to work in varying departments. So we have students that are in the ED, the emergency department. We have students that are doing sterilization for the operating rooms. So they run a myriad of work in a myriad of departments. And we have had students that have exited that program and become competitively employed through them.
Wow, that is fantastic. That's another success story.
It is.
Anything else you'd like to share with the listening audience before we close out?
I just want to thank everyone. I want to thank you first for the opportunity to talk about what I'm very passionate about, and that's our education for all students, but in particular our students with disabilities.
Well, I thank you for choosing Hampton City Schools and choosing to stay as well. And I say it time and time again, I've been around for quite some time. You are one of the best to do this work, and we appreciate all you do to positively impact the lives of our families in Hampton City Schools.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Yes, ma'am. So thank you, Ms. Judge, for being here today and highlighting our special education department. I am certain our listeners have taken away some valuable insight from our discussion. And to our listeners, remember, education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world. As one community, one transformation, we will ensure academic excellence for every child, every day, whatever it takes. We will catch you next week.
Listen to learn more about Hampton City Schools. New episodes of HCS Talks drop on Thursdays. Subscribe and listen to HCS Talks. HCS Talks is a Hampton City Schools production.